Morning, everybody. I know I try to keep my political videos to a minimum, but being an INFJ and a progressive, I've noticed another pattern that the Democratic Party, you know, my party, is perpetuating double standards and hypocrisy and, frankly, narcissistic behavior. So, being as that I'm me and I have integrity, I call it out because I call this stuff out to everyone, you know, regardless of what club they're in. I've never been a tribalist or a club, you know, type person. So basically, I've noticed that already the mainstream corporate media, you know, that the part of the media that props up the corporate Democrats, such as Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, are already slandering Marianne Williamson. Yes, there are, you know, predominantly women in the media slandering a woman running for president against an old white male good old boy. Now, you know, that goes against everything that the media has been saying since 2016. But why is it? Because they have no beliefs other than protect the club, protect the status quo at all costs, and try to twist facts and reality to best suit their narrative whenever they can do that. So, and I'll explain, because I'll back up what I say. I know, you know, nobody models going on a rant, but am I right? Just because somebody is famous and has a platform does not mean whatever they decide to say is correct because they're the one saying it. That's what narcissists do. Check out my narcissism videos if you just stumbled across this on some political forum. So in 2016, you know, it was evident in this country that Americans as a whole were sick of the status quo, sick of the establishment, the neocon George Bush style Republicans and the Bill Clinton style DLC third way corporate Democrats. Both sides decided, you know, we need anti-establishment, which caused the rise of Donald Trump, who ran as a faux populist because the way he governed, essentially, you know, yeah, he was right about the TPP and he did a few different things on trade, but with tax rates and everything else, he was, you know, your standard status quo Republican in how he governed, what actual policies he pushed, certainly not in the way he spoke. But policies are what matters. Politics is about policy and not optics, because it's the policies that affect us at the end of the day. And on the other side, you had the big Bernie Sanders movement, this move away from the, you know, DLC third way corporate Democrat GOP light brand of the Democratic Party that has been predominant since the rise of Bill Clinton in 1992, the king of the DLC. And the other main candidate was his wife, Hillary Clinton, the queen of the DLC. Now, right off the bat, they used the argument, well, Bernie's an old white male. They used everything, you know, disregard his voting record, which he votes for what he believes in through the decades he's been in office. Whereas you could see, you know, based on Hillary's Senate record and things she said, how she's flip-flop based on donor money. And that is one of the biggest things, is money in politics and campaign finance reform, because let's be honest, America essentially functions as an oligarchy. Even Janet Yellen admitted that during the Obama administration when questioned by Bernie Sanders. But the idea was simply put, well, Bernie's an old white man, Hillary's a woman. Never mind what they believe in, never mind, you know, which one is simply going to perpetuate the same status quo that has caused the collapse of the middle class that people are sick and tired of, which is what got Trump elected. It is Democrats, like, you know, it is third way centrist Democrats what created the rise of Trump, because the Democratic Party since the early 90s, especially with NAFTA, abandoned the working class, abandoned unions, and ran towards Silicon Valley and Wall Street and did things that hardcore Republicans like Ronald Reagan could only dream of, like, you know, the Gramm-Leach-Bliley Act, which repealed the Glass-Steagall Banking Reform Act that came in effect under Roosevelt, which kept there from being another Great Depression-like crash the whole time it was in power, and thus its removal was a big reason why the crash of 2008 happened. Also, a lot of policies under George Bush, mainly his large Reaganite tax cuts that turned a, in Clinton's defense, he had a budget surplus. Bush turned surplus into deficit, which is pretty, you know, pretty remarkable when you're starting out in the green and you take it right to the red, and all that green, instead of going back in the country and creating jobs or rebuilding infrastructure, went right into the bank accounts of the wealthiest 1%. But so, you know, the old saying, Bernie's a white male, but he wasn't part of the establishment. He was an independent who caucuses with the Democrats. And even speaking, you know, if you're just going to speak on identity politics, they negated the fact that had Bernie Sanders been elected, he would have been the first Jewish president. So even in the realm of identity politics, he's not just another old white male. Now, why do I bring this up? Well, fast forward to 2020. The old white male card was never used against Biden. He's not the first anything. Why is that? Why were they propping up, if it was so important in 2016 not to have an old white male candidate, why then was Joe Biden propped up? Because he's the establishment. He is the good old boys club. He is business as usual. He is a continuation of all the policies that have ruined this country, but all the donor class likes because they've stuffed their pockets with them. And people know that. People don't like those policies. So the only card they had to play is, you know, Trump bad, Trump bad, Trump bad, you know, Trump bad, status quo good. Don't question status quo. Anything better than Trump, just fall in line behind what we want. You know, there was no attempt to reach out to progressives or, you know, younger generations. When I mean younger generations, I mean anybody younger than the baby boomers. You know, the only people that politicians don't talk down to and belittle like they're 14 years old. Apparently, the only people in this country who matter are white middle-class boomers, particularly moderate Republicans, because Chuck Schumer even admitted, for every Democrat we lose in the working class, we'll get two moderate Republicans in the suburbs. And you can repeat that in Ohio and Pennsylvania. So yeah, so it's like progressives, fuck you, fall in line behind what we want. We're going after moderate Republicans. That's who we have to court. And we'll shame you if you don't show up for us because you owe us our allegiance because we're not the other guy. Yeah. You know, I can't walk up, you know, how would it look like if I walk up to a woman I'm interested in and tell her nothing about myself or how I'd be a good match for her, but simply, well, I'm a little bit better than the guy who used to beat you, so you have to settle for me now, fall in line. How well would that go? In 2022, they propped up any candidate that is the establishment. You know, people got flack for talking about Amy Klobuchar and how her campaign, not her as a person, but how her campaign lacked any substance. You know, if you go back and look at primary debates, most would classify, and I would agree, that most of Amy Klobuchar's answers and her platform were 1990s platitudes. There's this fetishization and obsession amongst the Democratic establishment with the 1990s. It's like, just do what Clinton did in 92. It'll work today. Doesn't matter that, you know, people that were voting in 92, a lot of them have died and a lot of people have thus become voting. The country has, everything's exactly as it was in 92. Just, you know, platitudes, establishment centrism. It's got to still be, you know, what was cool 30 years ago still has to be what's cool now, right? How's that true in anything? So they have to prop it up and they have to try to slander and keep down anybody who dare questions that. And anybody who is the establishment, if you try to question them, they'll try to cancel you. Like those that said, like, you know, Amy Klobuchar is, you know, out of touch. Like, it's not 1994 anymore. You know, and let's be honest, that Hillary Clinton, you know, while there were a lot of things that contributed to her loss, she did come across as very out of touch. And she ran a very 1990s style campaign, fueled with platitudes and cliches, while Bernie Sanders had policy substance. Whether or not I agree with your platform or not, Republican or Democrat, say what you believe in. Don't spew platitudes. I'm going to give you a bit of free advice that your pundits, the know-alls that are keeping you 30 years in the past, won't say. And if I'm wrong, back me up. You know, Gen X, millennials, and Gen Z, we hate platitudes. We know you're lying to us. We know it's bullshit. We know you're just basically telling us to fall in line. And I'm going to give you another big hint is we're sick and tired of being told to fall in line by baby boomers, because everything baby boomers have told us about, you know, college and how to be successful has been a lie. It's been a lie that not only didn't work for us, but somehow makes us wage slaves and putting more money in the pockets of a generation who are already the richest in history. Yeah. So there's that sense of rebellion there. Now, we do have some baby boomers that call that out. Elizabeth Warren is a great example. She would make a good president. But more recently, we do have someone with integrity who's saying, you know, the Biden administration is out of touch. Joe Biden doesn't get it. These neoliberal corporate policies are not going to fix this problem. In fact, they help contribute to the problem and they cause the rise of fascistic leaders like, you know, or neo-fascists like Donald Trump. And you see this in other countries too. You know, I follow some of the politics in the UK. About 10 years ago, they had a far-right party gaining momentum called the British National Party, especially in predominantly depressed white working class areas where the union jobs are gone. And these people were former labor voters that felt that the Labor Party abandoned them since 1997 when Tony Blair and New Labor came in and turned the Labor Party into a corporate neoliberal party. You see the same thing when the party that is supposed to be for the working class of all races and genders and backgrounds, you know, just working class economic status, abandons the working class and goes running towards the same money that the, you know, conservative right party does, those people have nowhere to go. And they'll latch on to any demigod figure that says, you've been left behind. This is messed up. I'm going to bring your jobs back. I'm going to fix this rigged system. I'm not going to serve whoever gives me money and tells me what to do and then say it's not even the appearance of corruption because money equals speech. Now, how does money equal speech? Because money paid for it. Money paid for the court to say money equals speech. Yes. So now we have Marianne Williamson who wants to challenge Biden. And it's disgusting to me on a couple levels to see, you know, all these people in the mainstream not even take her seriously, not even question her on the policies she believes or how she's going to implement them. It's like, oh, she's spiritual, you know, auras and crystals. Well, I'm a witch. Yeah, I'm a witch. Not only am I a witch, you know, my goddess is Lilith. So would women slander me for being a follower of the original feminist, of the most powerful woman ever? You know, simply because witchcraft and spirituality isn't mainstream. So it's okay to be a religious bigot as long as you're not doing it against like a religion like Christianity, because the club supports Christianity. And it just further perpetuates that life is just some continuation of high school and being in cliques and falling in line behind what's popular and nobody having integrity to speak up and say what they actually feel or do policies that'll actually benefit the majority of people instead of what'll stuff the most cash in your pocket. So I urge everybody to support a primary challenger. Joe Biden is not entitled to your vote. He is entitled to run for a second term within the Constitution, but just because he is the sitting president does not mean he is entitled to have the primary and run for a second term. He must earn that like every president before him. And it doesn't matter what the other side is putting up. It matters, do you have the policies that I support? Would I want you in office for 4 years perpetuating policies that may help me? I'm not going to fall in line behind you because you're the sitting president. If somebody else, no matter how much they slander them, actually has policies that I think are going to better my life, I'm going to support that person, particularly because that person hasn't had a shot. Marianne Williamson, we don't know what she can do in office. We know what Joe Biden's doing. Has he done a few good things? Yes. But is he taking it far enough to where the country is now? And also, you know, I have a hard time voting for a baby boomer supremacist. Joe Biden famously said he has no empathy for younger generations. Why should I vote for him? That'd be, would you ask an African American to vote for the guy in Louisiana, David Duke? You know, he's prejudiced against that group of people. Joe Biden admitted that he's prejudiced against people younger than his generation. I'm not going to fall in line behind him simply because he's the status quo and he's what the older generation wants. My life isn't about pleasing the older generation. They had their time in the sun. It's time for America to care about those of us that aren't of the baby boomer generation and stop treating us like children simply because we don't want to fall in line behind your failed neoliberal policies. And we'll vote for whoever we want, no matter how much you smear them. And you're not going to shame us into showing up for your guy because the monster on the right may get in the power. How about we get our way for once and you fall behind who we want and we let them show what they're capable of, because we know what your policies end up with and you want to keep it the same because it's what you've benefited from decades. And even though you're the richest generation in history, you still want more because the narcissism and the insatiable greed. Whoever dies with the most toys wins. Gimme, 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 mine, mine, mine. No. No.